Hi everyone, I'm Any New Province, and this week we're playing Jeskai Tokens for Net Benefits, the series where we explore the benefits of net decking in Pauper. This super sweet and successful go-wide deck comes from Ali, Code, and Drochit, who took it to a 5-0 finish in a Pauper League last week. Like the new powerful and popular blue-black one-drops, this deck is looking to take advantage of Brainstorm and Graveyard shenanigans to do powerful things your opponent has difficulty interacting with. Before I get into the deck tech, I just want to remind you that you can like the video or subscribe to the channel down below. I'd seriously appreciate it. It's a great way to let me know you've enjoyed everything, and it really encourages me to keep making great Pauper content. All right, let's get into Jeskai tokens. I'm going to start by going over some of the raw token production we have, things that we're not asking very much of besides put a couple of small yet serviceable bodies onto the battlefield. First, we have Sacred Cat, which costs 1 white mana for a 1/1 with lifelink, which is not that great on its own, but it has the Embalm ability, the first way we're going to be taking advantage of our graveyard. You can embalm Sacred Cat by paying 1 white mana. When you do, you exile Sacred Cat from your graveyard and create a token that's a copy of it, except it's a white zombie cat with no mana cost. You can only embalm as a sorcery. Embalm is really cool because it gets around your opponent's counter magic. They might be on all spell stutter sprites and condescends and hard counters, but we can just embalm a Sacred Cat out of our graveyard and start beating them down with a 1/1 lifelinker. Next, we have Anointer Priest, which I think is the most exciting inclusion in this deck. It costs 1 and a white for a 1/3 that says whenever a creature token enters the battlefield under your control, you gain 1 life. I'm really glad to have a 1/3 around in the first place, and a 1/3 that gains me a ton of life off of all the creature token generation we're doing, that's just gravy. But what's even better than all of that is that Anointer Priest has Embalm, so if we have to pitch it or mill it over with another one of our spells, we can still get a copy back on the battlefield by playing 3 and a white. The first of our instants and sorceries that generate creature tokens are Gather the Townsfolk and Raise the Alarm. We vary them even though they're functionally the same spell because the creature tokens they produce have different names. This helps us play around things like Echoing Truth or Echoing Decay. Both spells cost 1 and a white for instants that create 2 1/1 white soldier creature tokens, generating life off of our Anointer Priest and helping us go wide to start chipping away at our opponent's life total. Our final token production spell is arguably the most powerful in Battle Screech. It costs 2 white for a sorcery that creates 2 1/1 white bird creature tokens with flying. What really puts Battle Screech over the top and helps it fill in with all of our graveyard synergies is its flashback ability. You can cast Battle Screech out of your graveyard by tapping 3 untapped white creatures you control, then you exile it. This deck is running exactly 1 non-token based creature threat, and it's an important one. It's Seeker of the Way, which costs 1 white for a 2/2 with prowess. Prowess says whenever you cast a non-creature spell, this creature gets +1/+1 until end of turn, and if that wasn't enough, whenever you cast a non-creature spell, Seeker of the Way also gains lifelink until end of turn. Next, I'm going to talk about all of the spells we're going to use to get the top of our deck into our graveyard. This is going to give us a ton of card selection because cards like Sacred Cat, Anointer Priest, and Battle Screech can just be cast from the graveyard anyway. It's like an extension of our hand at that point. We have 1 copy of Mental Note and 4 copies of Thought Scour. Like Raise the Alarm and Gather the Townsfolk, these are functionally the same, but we just wanted 1 extra copy. Both spells cost 1 mana for an instant that causes target player to put the top 2 cards of their library into their graveyard, usually us. After you do that, you draw a card. We're also running 2 copies of Faithless Looting, which costs 1 red mana for sorceries that draw you 2 cards, then discard you 2 cards. If you mill over them with Thought Scour or Mental Note, that's okay because they have the flashback ability. You can pay 2 and a red, exile Faithless Looting from your graveyard, draw 2 more cards, discard 2 more cards, and hopefully continue going off with your graveyard shenanigans. This deck isn't looking to just produce creatures out of its graveyard with Battle Screech and Sacred Cat. It actually has a whole other package filled with a variety of really cool graveyard activated effects. The first of those effects comes in the form of a couple copies of Prismatic Strands, which cost 2 and a white for an instant that prevent all damage that the sources of the color of your choice would deal this turn. The best part, it has flashback. You can cast it out of your graveyard at instant speed by simply tapping an untapped white creature you control. Prismatic Strands is great against monocolored aggressive decks, and even against some decks like Burn. We're always going to have a white creature around, so we may even get 2 activations out of each of these prismatic strands. Next, we have Rally the Peasants, one of the coolest cards to use to win a game out of nowhere. It costs 2 and a white for an instant that gives creatures you control +2/+0 until end of turn. You can cast it again with flashback out of your graveyard by paying 2 and a red. By the time you've cast and flashback a battle screech, you should have enough mana on the battlefield to just win with a double cast of Rally the Peasants. This card is insane. If continuously antheming our creatures doesn't somehow get us there, we have a single copy of Firebolt we may be able to cast out of our graveyard to do the trick. Normally it costs 1 red mana to deal 2 damage to any target, but you can flash it back out of your graveyard for 4 and a red. Our last graveyard centric spell is one of the best pieces of card advantage in the format. It's Deep Analysis. It costs 3 and a blue and allows you to draw 2 cards at sorcery speed, but the best part is you can just cast it again out of your graveyard for its flashback cost of 1 and a blue and 3 life. I mentioned that this deck was trying to take advantage of Brainstorm in the same way that blue black one drops is, so of course it's running 4 full copies of Brainstorm, which costs 1 blue for instants that draw 3 cards. Then you must put 2 cards from your hand on the top of your library in any order. If we put back a couple of cards we don't like, no big deal, we can just get rid of them with Thought Scour or Mental Note. This deck is also running multiple fetch lands in its mana base that'll help us shuffle and get rid of those cards we don't want as well. I also mentioned that sometimes we won't be able to kill our opponent using just creature damage, so just to be safe, we have 3 copies of Lightning Bolt as well. They cost 1 red mana for an instant that just deal 3 damage to any target. We're probably all pretty aware of how hard it is to play a 3-color deck in Pauper, so we'll start the mana base out with our last non-land card, which is Springleaf Drum. Springleaf Drum costs 1 generic mana for an artifact that you can tap and also tap an untapped creature you control to add 1 mana of any color to your mana pool. It feels a little bit risky to run Springleaf Drum in any deck that doesn't care about artifacts like Affinity, but I'm pretty confident we'll always have the creature to tap, so I'm okay having a Springleaf Drum or 2 here to help fix our mana base. Speaking of which, let's have a look at these lands. First, we have 3 copies of Ash Barrens, just great color fixing. Normally they only tap for 1 colorless mana, but if they're still in your hand, you can pay 1 generic mana to discard them, search your library for a basic land card, put it into your hand, and then shuffle your library. We have 4 more fetches in the form of Evolving Wilds. You can tap them and sacrifice them to search your library for a basic land card, put it onto the battlefield tapped, then shuffle your library. I think it's really interesting how few non-basic lands this deck builder decided to use. In fact, we only have 3 more in the form of 3 Azorius Chanceries, your blue-white Karus. They enter the battlefield tapped. When they enter the battlefield, you return a land you control to your hand. When they're untapped, they add blue and white. Finally, we have our basics in the form of 4 islands, 4 plains, and 2 mountains. Lots of untapped white and blue sources. Did our Sacred Cats and our Thought Scours on time get those graveyard shenanigans going, and just enough mountains that we can trigger an early Lightning Bolt to kill a threat that might kill us. All right, let's have a look at this sideboard. First, we have 2 copies of Veteran Armorer for going up against those Electricory decks. We have 1 copy of Standard Bearer for picking up our opponent's pump spells and auras. We have a ton of Wraths and 3 copies of Electricory and 3 copies of Swirling Sandstorm. We have another Prismatic Strands for fogging our opponent's elves or getting an extra turn off burn. We have an Ancient Grudge because we're technically a 5-color deck. We have all those Springleaf Drums. We have 1 copy of Ray of Revelation as a way to destroy our opponent's enchantments out of our graveyard. We have a Lightning Bolt for those ultra fast decks if we have to kill their threats, or just for going to our opponent's face if we're the beatdown. And speaking of being the beatdown, we have 2 more Anthems and a couple more Ramosian Rallies. And there you have it, Jeskai Tokens by Ali, Code, and Drochit. Congratulations again for your 5-0. We're going to take this deck into a league at twitch.tv/anynewprovince. We're there every Monday night at 7 p.m. Atlantic time playing competitive Pauper decks. Before I go, I just want to remind you that you can like the video or subscribe to the channel down below. I'd seriously appreciate it. It's a great way to let me know you've enjoyed everything, and it really encourages me to keep making great Pauper content. I hope you enjoyed this deck tech, and hopefully I'll see you on Monday night.